But God is an awesome God. So, you know, we're celebrating 100 years. We don't want to kind of break any rules or be goats instead of sheep. But we want to really praise God today through song. So y'all just give us a little time to kind of celebrate this occasion. I've not directed since COVID. How many years has that been? Over 2. I've gained that much weight. And I feel it in my hands, in my feet, in my knees. But we're going to play. Just stretch your hands and say, God, anoint. Hey, babosha. We thank God for it. But we're going to sing. We thank everybody. The liturgical dance from City of Faith. You all were absolutely anointed of God. I mean, if I would have known y'all when I was with a PW choir, y'all would have been flown in to do some work. But I'll keep you in mind just in case. You all were a blessing and anointed of God. Church of Joel, you all sang. Now, I got to tell you something. You sang first and you sang one of the songs on our list. But we sing it differently. So I got a little part from you all and hope you catch a little part of ours. All right? On Pass Me Not. All right? So we going to do it because we worked hard. We didn't really have a rehearsal but about, 30 minutes today as we were full off of Jack's and the food truck and everybody else. But I'm so glad to see everybody here today. Give yourselves a hand. One more thing before we bless God. The songs do not have in the middle of them, but you may hear a lot of that, all right? So, I didn't teach them that way. I want y'all to know. But you'll hear some of that because they, you know, dusting off. But I got to do one more thing. Sister Jocelyn Morton, is she here? Back here. Come on up, please, sis. James Jackson, you have something for me. Just bear with us, James. Guys, we gonna stir the praise. We gonna keep it up. You almost got some footwork out of me. But I can't do nothing but a two-step right now. But the anointing is in the place. The message for today is it won't be long now, Bishop. The prophecy was spoken this morning from Dr. Turk, and it's continued on. It won't be long, GCT. I want my friend, my big sis, my cut-up buddy, for years in a church. I don't know why they let me sit by them or let me sit by her wherever we went, but I always end up sitting by her, and if y'all know this sister, she could never hide her leg. I would sit up with a straight face, and all you saw were her shoulders. She couldn't stand me, but she let me sit by every time. Hey, this great woman of God, the orator of Greater Christ Open Church. When I tell you she can put the words together and set the house on fire. She would introduce the songs before we sang them. And choir, a lot of times you couldn't even sing because this woman of God would have preached the word and destroyed. I'm like, man, I can't even sing that song now because the Lord had given her a word to speak. Sister Shatika Merritt. She was minister of music for years. She had a car accident, crushed both of her knees, busted wide open to the white meat, and the choir was in limbo. God works crazy. I just stepped up and helped take over, and from that point on, we worked together. But this award says to Sister Shatika Merritt, thank you for your years of dedication and service to the GCT Music Department. GCT 100 Year Celebration, December 11th today, 2022. Come on, y'all. Give it up for Sweet Pea. Sweet Pea don't, she can't take care of plants, so I won't give her flowers because they'll be dead on the way home. But we all know cactus died in Sweet Pea's presence, but she's a flower and a jewel to Greater Christ Temple Church. Always the same, holiness or hell, Misha Star, she get on to all of us, holiness or hell. But we appreciate Sweet Pea. Y'all ready, choir?
Excuse me. I want to interrupt this time and present a special presentation to none other than my brother, Brother Sherman Merritt, the Matrix, anointed man of God, can take a small group of people and make it sound the sound of heaven. I thank God for the anointed man of God to use him in a mighty way. He's more than just a director, y'all. God has so much in him. He's more than a director. Sometimes God stretches us in places. He can do this with his eyes closed. And God has called him to a higher calling. And it's time for you to walk in that calling that God has called you to walk. You have been through too many things. You have overcome so many things. Character assassination, defamation of character. But the Lord has called you to rise above the storm. And you are the man that God has designed you to be. So come on up a little higher and preach the word of God in season, out of season, and make the liar out of the devil. Hallelujah! 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 So many people call you for help. You have encouraged so many people. I think your calling is to be, let's just say, a psychologist, because you know how to minister to the needs of the people. And Christ have need of you this day, right now, to preach the word. Because people are standing and waiting for your obedience. It's locked up in your ministry and your obedience. So when you stand before the Lord, he's going to say, well done, my good and faithful servant. So it's time now to come on up a little higher. It's time now to be stretched and let God, everything that he's imparted in you, it's time now to release that anointing that God has put in your life. It's time now to release it in the name of Jesus. I call it forth, man of God, son of thunder, in the name of Jesus.
All praises be to the King of Kings. For the Lord our God, he's what? He is! How did it creep on? Bishop loves anthems. I've not sang this since Bobby came out. I didn't know everybody remembered it, but we kind of got through it. I remember, how many remember? Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Pray for us.
Yeah!
We made it. All of y'all breathing here tonight. So what does the word say? Let everything that has breath do what? You are created to do what? Give voices to do what? I will not let a rock cry out for me, for therefore I will what? Come on. We're going to go on real quick, Pastor. This is 100 years. We come to celebrate. Some of y'all are going to call in tomorrow, too. Because we're going to be too sore to wake up tomorrow, because we're going to give God some praise. Pass me not. Now, we got a little twist on it, too. We've been doing it for years. But we're going to join together and sing it, all right? Come on. Put those hands together like this. Brother Michael Neal. Brother Michael Neal been my assistant for many, many years. Very anointed and talented God. God. Y'all remember this one. Seemed like he's taking it every other Sunday. Wonderful things happen in the presence of the Lord. See, we're already in the presence of the Lord. So if you're expecting God to do something, this is the time for God to do it. Because in his presence, wonderful things, miracles, healing, deliverance happen in the presence of the Lord. Come on, Mike.
Come on, Mike.
Josh. gonna move on. Bishop, we almost got your hair, I promise you. Cause this man of God preached this morning, am I right? Yeah. Come on, Sister Nikki. We gonna do a little bit of There Is No Way. I can live without him.
Yeah. Oh, a great word. Amen. A great word. Amen. And we are glad that he was the chosen one for this occasion. Yes. Just prove it that God knows what he's doing. And so I bring to you, and I pray that you all do not walk. Let him finish, make an altar call, and then we would dismiss, amen, as we normally do. I want everybody to stand on your feet again. It is my pleasure to introduce a man of God that is anointed. He is a teacher. He's a professor in his field, well-trained. He loves the Lord and highly anointed. You don't get that in one person as often as you would like. But we are blessed to have a man of God here, Suffragan Bishop here, Lamont Turner. Amen. Let's put our hands together and give the Lord the high praise for him. Come on, y'all can do better than that. If y'all can put it together for that, let's give the Lord a high praise for Bishop Dr. Turner.
Be seated. God bless you. It is again just an extreme privilege of mine to be with you today, and I'm just grateful for what God has done in this place and on the morning service and also during this service as well. It's just good for us to be here, and I honor Jesus, as I said earlier, and I'll say it always. He is my God, my King, Lord, and Savior, and I know for sure that without him, I am nothing. To your very fine pastor, the Honorable Bishop Sherman Merritt, and his lovely wife, God bless you both. It is just such a privilege to be with you, and thank you, sir, for entrusting us in this assignment. I have, and as I told him privately, and I'll say it publicly as well, great admiration for his ministry, his gifting, his dedication to the Word of God, and so he is highly admired. And so thank you, sir, for your service in the kingdom of God to my apostolic father, the Honorable Bishop James Nelson, and his lovely wife, Mother Nelson. It's just so great to be with you all today. That's just a happy bonus that I get to hang out with them today. And so God bless you. God bless you both. Bishop was, when I first became the pastor of Zion, I was there probably just a couple of days, and the pastor who was leaving took me by his house, and we sat and we talked, and he gave me some advice and some things I won't tell you over the pulpit, but he said some things that absolutely blessed me, and over the years I have learned that his wisdom rings true. And so thank you, sir, for that wisdom. We certainly appreciate you. And to my dear friend, just to go to Williams, it's just always a pleasure to be with him. Our families go back years and years and years. Our fathers were friends, and we certainly shared in the ministry there in Knoxville. And so thank you, sir, for joining us on today. To all of God's people, it's just good to be here. To Lady Rebecca and then Elder Cliff, I've just got a chance to meet you all today. Known you from afar from at the convention for years, but I got a pleasure to meet you today, and so thank you so much for your kindness. Give me 15 minutes and we're going to be out of your way. Leviticus, the 6th chapter, verse 8 through 13. Leviticus 6, verse 8 through 13. And again, I'm reading from the ESV. Tremendous, tremendous choir. You guys are absolutely amazing. And so thank you so much for sharing today. Verse 8 says, "The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, command Aaron and his sons, saying, this is the law of the burnt offering. The burnt offering shall be kept on the hearth of the on the altar all night until the morning. And the fire of the altar shall be kept burning on it. And the priest shall put on his linen garment and put his linen undergarment on his body. And he shall take up the ashes to which the fire has reduced the burnt offering on the altar and put them beside the altar. Then he shall take his off his garments and put on other garments and carry the ashes outside the camp to a clean place. The fire on the altar shall be kept burning on it. It shall not go out. The priest shall burn wood on it every morning, and he shall arrange the burnt offering on it, and shall keep it and keep on it the fat of the peace offerings. Notice again, the fire shall be kept burning on the altar continually. It shall not go out. I want to focus primarily on verse 9 and 12 and 13. The end of 9 says, the fire on the altar shall be kept burning on it. Verse 12 says, the fire on the altar shall be kept burning on it. It shall not go out. Verse 13 says, fire shall be kept burning on the altar continually. It shall not go out. If you'll just help me to the person next to you, keep the fire burning. Come on, tell one more person, keep the fire burning. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you for this privilege. Thank you for this great church. Thank you, Father, for what you're doing in this place continually. Thank you, Lord, for the rich history that is here and the bright future that is ahead. I'll ask, Father, in these few moments that we have, that you would grant your servant the understanding to articulate, Lord, what it is that you're saying in this hour. We shall praise you and thank you now and always in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, you can be seated. Keep the fire burning. All throughout the scripture, we have examples of divine fire falling for the approval of God. You'll see fire that fell on Abel's sacrifice. Fire fell at the dedication of the altar and the tabernacle of Moses. Fire fell on the altar that David had placed before the Lord and at the time that he was going to bring the ark in. Fire fell at Solomon's temple when he dedicated the temple before the Lord. Fire fell on Elijah's altar on Mount Carmel. And if we were to take the time today to typify the cross of Jesus Christ, I would suggest to you that fire fell on Jesus as he was the sacrifice for our sins. He cannot be the Lamb of God, which would take away the sin of the world, and he not being that burnt sacrifice for us. According to Romans, the 6th chapter and the 6th verse, it tells us that the body of sin was destroyed. Thank God for that. And so since the body of sin was destroyed, there is no record of the sin of you and I, for Christ has taken it all away, and that is absolutely fascinating. So he was the sacrifice for our sins, who was judged for us all, the perfect and ideal sacrifice. Fire fell on the day of Pentecost when 120 worshipers gathered in the upper room and the cloven tongues like as of fire. So we discover that fire is seen in the presence of God as the approval of Almighty God. Now, I don't have the time today to take you through a hermeneutics class and to show you through the scriptures what that means. But I will give you this one principle. If you were in my hermeneutics class, I would teach you what is called the first principle or first mention principle. The first mention principle in hermeneutics is where an object or a thing or a place or an idea is mentioned for the very first time in scripture. That thing, place, person, name, whatever it may be, then sets a precedence for everything else that it is seen or it is typified as all throughout the scripture. So then where is the first time that fire is mentioned in your Bible? It is Genesis, the 3rd chapter and the 24th verse, where the sword that turned every way, the Bible says, it was a flaming sword, flaming sword. The scripture tells us this sword turned every way to keep the way to the tree of life. you know, as it is, Adam and the woman, or the man and the male and female, they ate of the tree in the midst of the garden. And when they ate then, God had to judge them. One of those judgments was expulsion from the garden. The reason being is if they were to eat of the tree of life in the current condition, then God would have to sanctify or make holy sin, and he cannot do that. So he must remove them from the garden, so they would not live forever in sin. So Bishop Haywood wrote the book, The Victim of the Flaming Sword, mentioning that Jesus was the victim of that sword, who would die by the sword and rise again to partake of the tree of life, to give it unto us. That's why he can say, no man takes my life. I've got the power to lay it down. I've got the power to take it up again. And so we discover in our Bible that God uses fire from Genesis all the way through Revelations. When you get to the 19th chapter of Revelation, you're going to discover that the Lord Jesus Christ, who is riding on the white horse, the scripture says his eyes are like fire. His eyes are like fire, which is again extraordinary, because what it shows us is that not only is he holy, but he judges you by his eyes. He judges you by his eyes. But he doesn't just judge you with his eyes. Fire is seen for purification as well. So with his eyes, he not only judges you, but he purifies you, bless his holy name, with his eyes. So for Elijah then, fire is seen on Mount Carmel when he challenges the prophets of Baal and Ashtoreth, as he challenges them and says that the God that answers by fire, he will be God. Now, I need you to understand exactly what's being stated there. Elijah says that the God who answers, or who responds, hallelujah, or who communicates by fire, he will be God. So then we see, then you know the story. The Lord sent fire down from heaven. It burnt the sacrifice that was there, licked up all the water, and the fire was so hot that it caused the stones to disintegrate, because our God is a consuming fire. But here's what I need you to see: the God who answers, he's the God who answers by fire, suggesting then he's the God that speaks using fire, or he is the God that talks by fire. Hallelujah. I can back it up using the 19th chapter of Exodus. Remember when Moses and the people of Israel, they came to Mount Sinai, and there was this fascinating scene where fire came down from heaven and it consumed the very mountain. All the people of Israel looked on while this mountain was ablaze with fire. And then as this mountain was ablaze with fire, all the way up to heaven is an extraordinary sight. God says to Moses, come here to the mountain and let me talk to you. And not only does he say, come here, let me talk to you, he says, come up into the mountain, which is really interesting, because how many of you would actually, first of all, approach a mountain that's on fire, let alone go up into the mountain? But God was using fire to speak to Moses. Then the people said to Moses, listen, that's too much for us, bruh. You can go on by yourself. They said, we'll stay right here. You talk to God on your own. So Moses became the delegate for the people, and he spoke to God in the midst of the fire. Children of God, I need you to understand that the scripture shows us that fire is seen for purification. According to Numbers 31, that anything dedicated to God must go through the waters of purification, as well as also through the fire of purification. Anything dedicated to God must go through the water of purification and the fire of purification. Anything dedicated to God must go through the water of purification and through the fire of purification. That's why John would come preaching. He says, all I can do is baptize you with water unto repentance. But there is coming somebody that's after me who's actually preferred before me because he actually was before me. I can't even tie his shoe, let alone carry his shoes. This coming one will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. So we discover that Jesus is the Spirit baptizer, as well as also he is the fire baptizer. Hallelujah. He's the Spirit baptizer and he is the fire baptizer. So then globally what we discovered, because we are creationists and we believe in a global flood, we understand that the world was deluged by water in the days of Noah, experiencing then a water baptism. From the day that Jesus Christ died upon the cross and released his Spirit into the earth, he has steadily been baptizing the world, hear me, chosen of God, with his Spirit. That's why Joel can say, and Peter says, that in the last days, saith God, I will pour out my Spirit on all, not Pentecostals alone, hallelujah, not apostolics alone. He said, I'll pour out my Spirit on all flesh. So the Lord has been baptizing this whole world with his Spirit. Peter then picks up and tells us that the world that is coming, the world that we have now, will be scorched or will be baptized by fire. So we're seeing water baptism, Spirit baptism, and fire baptism. Children of God, that says to us that there is for you not only a water baptism, but there is a Spirit baptism. And there is a baptism, glory to God, by fire, that the Lord himself, as he came on the day of Pentecost, you were in the upper room along with the rest of them talking in tongues. But you remember there was a fire that entered into the room. That one fire divided into 120 fires, and it set upon each of them. So then simultaneously what you discover is that as they were baptized in the Spirit, they were also baptized in the fire of God. Simultaneously, the Spirit of God and the fire of God, is because God works in threefold things: the outer court, the inner court, the most holy place. He is revealed as the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. He is divine light. He is natural light. He is artificial light. I'm trying to tell you, God moves in threefold things. So therefore, the experience for the believer, he's going to take us through and has taken us through water baptism and Spirit baptism. And fire baptism all at the same time. I'm almost done. And here's what you'll see then. In the text, what we discover is the Lord spoke unto Moses and unto Aaron and said to them, I'm going to ignite the altar with fire. All I want you to do is put the sacrifice there, and I'll be the one who will start the fire. So here's what happened. They had the entire tabernacle set up, and as they had each vessel in place, from the brazen altar, the brazen laver, to the table of showbread and the menorah, which is the candlesticks, and the altar of incense, and as well as also the Ark of the Covenant, each vessel being in place, they had a sacrifice laid on the altar. This sacrifice had wood underneath it, but they were not responsible for starting the fire. God said, put it there, I'll be the one that does it. And the scripture then shows the most ironic thing, that fire came not from heaven, but the fire came from the most holy place. I could see if someone walked up and, you know, like we do at cookouts, you use a lighter fluid and you use something to ignite the fire and the fire go up. But that's not what God did. Here they are all standing around, and all of a sudden from the most holy place, a fire shot out. It came through the veil. veil. It came through the door, but you discover the veil didn't catch on fire. Glory to God. The door didn't catch on fire. The metal in the place did not melt. It passed by the altar of incense. It came between the golden candlesticks and the table of showbread. It shot out through the door. It went past the brazen laver, which was filled with water, but it didn't take the water away. Way and the water didn't evaporate, and then all of a sudden that fire hit the altar. And as the fire hit the altar, the sacrifice went up in the flames. And if I were there, much like you as Pentecostals, we would have broke out in a shout and a dance, because we noticed that God has done something powerful and something unique. Then the Lord says to them, I will start it, but it's your job to keep the fire burning. I'm going to give you the responsibility. Make sure you keep adding wood to the fire, because the fire must not go out. It's got to burn in the morning. It's got to burn through the afternoon. It's got to burn through the night, which would mean then that somebody had to sit up all night making sure that the embers were still burning and that the soot would not cause the fire to be smothered. Somebody had to keep stoking to make sure that they're adding wood to the fire, removing the ash so the embers could burn bright orange. And as they kept feeding the fire, they knew it's my responsibility. Don't let it go out. There's a scripture that shows that they came at the time of the evening sacrifice. The two sons of Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, they realized that the time to offer incense was close. And so what they decided to do, because there was one fire on the altar, but they had what we call common fires in the outer court. The common fires were for the priest and the high priest to use to wash of the dry clothes and to use it to cook their meat. But the Lord said, whenever you offer incense, it must be from my altar. But in a hurry, what they did, they noticed it's about time for us to offer the incense. So they rushed to the closest fire, and they picked up the coals from that altar, took it and tried to go into the most holy, the holy place. As they got to the door, children of God, you got to understand that the fire that they were using was in the tabernacle proper. It didn't come from outside the gate of the tabernacle. It wasn't in the community of the people. It wasn't used at the outhouse. This particular fire that they were using was in the tabernacle proper. But God said, I only have one fire that I want you to use. So when they got to the door of the tabernacle, God was saying, no further. The Bible says that the same fire that ignited the altar came out once again, and it burnt Nadab and Abihu. And we call that strange fire. Children of God, I need you to know, there's only one fire that comes from God. You can try your best to replicate that fire. You can try your best to use a synthetic version of that fire. There's only one fire. There's only one God. There's only one anointing. There's only one way. There's only one truth. There's only one light. Children of God, the Lord says to us, we are responsible to keep the fire burning. So my question as I go to my seat, when was the last time you decided, God, you ignited me, but I'll keep it
we had the kind of services where the power of God would fall. Music would be over. Preaching would be done. Nobody else is singing, but the saints are still rejoicing. And we still be in there praising and blessing God. They'd have to carry you to your car, put you inside, because the deacons were saying, time to go home now. But you were so caught up in the Spirit of God, you didn't care what time it was. You didn't care if anybody was singing. You didn't care if anybody were preaching. You didn't care if anybody was playing. You just knew that the fire of God hit your soul, and you decided, I'm gonna keep adding to this fire. I'm saying to you, church, that what the world needs is the fire of God. Demons can't stand before that fire. Sickness leaves when that fire comes. Healing breaks out in that fire. I'm finishing now, but I remember this distinctly. My uncle, who had back problems, had a back surgery. He loved to dance in church. They released him from the hospital, and as they released him, we were having revival that night. He told them, take me to church. They kept saying, no, you're in no condition. You gotta go home. You need to rest. But my uncle said, no, take me to church. My healing is there. They had to carry him up the steps. He had his walker going down the center aisle, went to his usual seat, and when the praises went up, he grabbed the hold of the seat, the end of it, stood up, and just started rocking back and forth. I can remember him saying, I'm gonna keep on praising you, God. I'll keep on praising you, God. His children said, Dad, sit down. You just came from the hospital. You just had back surgery. You shouldn't be standing. He told them, you can't stop me from praising my God. Service kept going. Still sitting, didn't sit down. Offering went on. He's still up saying, I'm going to praise your God. You've been good to me. Preacher got up and was preaching. Uncle still up, grabbing the end of the pew. About this time, he's bent over. You can tell he's in pain. His children kept saying, Dad, sit down. Uncle kept on rocking and said, Dad, Lord, I'll praise you. Preacher got finished. Altar call was made. All of a sudden, that same uncle who was bent over went out in the alleyway and kept telling God, I'll praise you. I'll praise you. And before long, his hand that was gripped on the end of the pew was released from the pew. Both hands were up, and he kept saying, God, I'll praise you. I'll praise you. I'll praise you. And before long, my uncle started dancing. No music was playing, but he started dancing. The whole church started looking and noticed, wait a minute, it was a few days ago that he was in the hospital. It was a few days ago that he had back surgery. How is it possible that he's out there in the middle aisle dancing and praising God? You can't imagine what happened in that service. Everybody went up and started blessing God. I'm saying to you, my uncle decided, I don't care if I'm in pain. I don't care if I'm sick. I refuse to let the fire die. I will bless the Lord at all times. Children of God, I say to you, you. Keep the fire burning. Your children need it. Keep the fire burning. Your neighborhood needs it. Keep the fire burning. Nashville needs it. Keep the fire burning. The United States needs it. Keep the fire burning. The world needs it. Keep the fire burning. And whatever you do, don't let the fire go out. Add your praise, add your hallelujah, add your thank you, Jesus. But whatever you do, don't let the fire go out.
Come on, open your mouth and praise him right there. I said, open your mouth and praise him right there. Amen. Open your mouth and just watch God light a fire on the inside. All you got to do is say, I won't stop praising you, Lord, until you bless. I won't stop blessing you, Lord, until you just bless me, Lord, again. Open your mouth right quick. Raise your hands all over this building. The word of the Lord is getting ready to send a fire in a whole lot of people. Some people don't realize how much they need a fire to light itself on the inside. You won't have a burnout. You won't be stagnated. Amen. Let the fire burn right now, and your excitement about your salvation will come back in your life. The anointing will be increased. Amen. Right in your life. Things to start to change when you let the fire burn. Amen. Somebody raise your hand. Give the Lord a praise right in the house. The word of the Lord has already been said. It should be inspiring, because whatever lands on the fire will be burned up. And whatever the devil is trying to do to put water on the fire, anybody know about a grease fire? The last thing you should do is throw water on a grease fire, because all it would do is expand itself. When you got the anointing and the devil trying to put the fire out, amen, and hit that fire, is going to expand, and God gonna do some great things in your life. If as a man, a woman, girl, or a boy that is in this place right now, take advantage of the opportunity. You don't have to go out of here the same as you came in here. Maybe you've been through some things. Maybe you have lost that feeling that you used to have about the Lord. Maybe you're not as inspired as you used to be. Maybe you don't feel the presence of God in your life like you used to have. And what the Lord says, come on and get a light. Get a boost from the fire that already exists. The Lord has the fire starter. And somebody used to sing that song, God don't need no matches, because it's fire all by himself. Is there anybody want to be baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Ghost? Anybody want to be there? Anybody want to experience that? Anybody want the Lord to purge out? Purge out anything that is not right on the inside of you, so you can present yourself before the Lord, and the Lord will welcome you into his presence. Is there one? Is there anybody could come? This is a new beginning for us. This is an ending of 100 years and the beginning of a new start. And I just want you to come and take advantage of it. I want you to know that the Lord can do more. What's in front of you is better than what he's already done behind you. Is there somebody? Thank you. Is there somebody else? We got altar workers. We got people here to lay hands on you. You can't stay down. You can't miss out on the presence of God. Because the greatest thing that ever happened to you is that that relationship with the Lord will grow stronger. At a time when you need to feel the Lord, come on, the opportunity is here right now. Don't sit back in the church and not move when God is already fixing everything. setting everything for us. Is there one? Is there anybody? We got water. We got pool. We got somebody baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. And you shall, not all probably could, but you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. After the Holy Ghost come, you shall have power. You shall be powerful. Raise your hand. Father in heaven, again, we thank you for the message. We thank you for the messenger. We pray that you will continue to use this vessel to bring revelation into the hearts and minds of your people. We thank you, Lord, because he has shown us how valuable that you are in our life and how important you are to us. And without you, Lord, we could do nothing. Thank you for the caring. Thank you for speaking into the hearts of your people. Thank you for awakening those that have gone to sleep and bring back, Lord Jesus, a new anointing in their life. In Jesus' name, somebody put your hands together. Say, in Jesus' name. Come on, somebody holler it out real loud. Say, in Jesus' name. I can't hear you. Say, in Jesus' name. Amen. Everything is going to be all right. You can sit now. We thank God for all of you. We've said it over and over again. There's a whole lot of close friends that we have here, and we don't want to take it for granted, but we just thank God that they have come from their busy schedules for just to be with us in this service. I can't tell you how much I feel comfortable and secure when you're around and save people and people that love the Lord. So I want to thank all of you for coming, for the church, your support during this last portion of this 100-year celebration. You have responded well in the dinner. You responded in working. You responded in just opening your hearts up and making yourself available to us. And we thank you for all of your substance that you have given, sacrifices that you made. We didn't get to where we are today by anything that we've done, but it's by the mercies of God. It's by the glory of God that we give him all the praise. Amen. We can't pat ourselves on the back and be realistic. We can look back and we can't even see how we made it this far. But therefore, obtaining help from God. I didn't hear nobody say that. Therefore, obtaining help from God, we continue into this day. And so we just thank you for the power and the anointing. So